Hey, everybody. How you guys doing? Come on, you guys. It's Friday night. There aren't a lot of you in the crowd tonight. I need to hear it. How are you guys doing tonight? Okay. That was really good. I'm proud of you guys. Thank you. Hey, how's everybody doing tonight? Welcome to Sick Puppy Stand-Up Night. Okay, thank you. All right, cool, thanks. Tonight's show is brought to you by Target. Just need to thank our sponsor. My name is Ben. I'll be your host for this evening. I'm just happy to be here, you guys. I'm happy to be here. I'm happy to be out of work. I hate my job. It's just the worst. Does anybody hate their job here in the audience tonight? Yeah, it is. Wait, did somebody boo? Oh, I know who that is. He hates his job too, don't worry. It's just the worst, you guys. I'm getting older, you know? Like, I became an adult and I had to get a 9-to-5 job. And I'm just not cut out for the 9-to-5 lifestyle, you know what I mean? I don't want to talk to people about what they made for dinner last night, because there's like always a guy who wants to tell me like, oh, Ben, I made the best chili the other night. I gotta tell you, the secret is, you put a little hot sauce in there, you put a little molasses, you put a little cayenne pepper in there, and I just have to stand there and be like, okay, so the secret's the recipe. Like, this is really cool, like, this is great. I don't wanna talk to that guy, you know? I don't wanna talk to people who wanna talk about conspiracy theories, you know? Do you guys have a conspiracy theorist in your family or at your job that you have to deal with, anybody? Yeah? Do they believe, like, the weirdest shit or what? Like, have you guys heard the one about the $20 bill? That if you fold a $20 bill a certain way, you could see the Twin Towers, they're smoking. Has anybody heard of that? Yes? Like, can you believe that people think that's a real thing? That's the most insane thing to me, that somebody thinks there was like an Illuminati meeting years before the event happened, and they're setting it all up, like, all right, I think we got everything pretty well set up. Anybody have anything else they want to add to this meeting before we call it quits for the night? And then, like, weird Jim's hand shoots up from the back of the room and he says, do you guys read Mad Magazine? What does that have to do with what we're talking about here, Jim? Well, you remember how they have a picture on the back page, and then if you folded the page, it made it look like another picture? Yeah. Can we do that with this? What are you talking about, Jim? You know, foreshadowing, like Breaking Bad. And if you guys don't think the Illuminati had Breaking Bad years before we did, then you need to wake up. And the leader just looks at him and says, Jim, that is brilliant. Get the Treasury on the phone right now. We're gonna get these things minted toot sweet. Like, it's fucking crazy. And I don't wanna sound like the guy who shits on every single conspiracy theory there is, right? Like, I believe some of them, you know? For example, I genuinely believe that the government puts a chemical in our water supply that makes women not want to have sex with me. It's the only possible explanation for that, but yeah, I don't know, man. So like, the point of this is I hate my job, right? And I'm thinking about things I could do to get myself out of the office life, out of the 9-to-5 lifestyle, because I'm not cut out for it. So I thought, like, maybe I could become an Uber driver. That's a thing. Like, I took an Uber ride for the first time not super long ago, and I thought it was interesting, you know? I got to talk to the driver, had a nice conversation. He seemed like he enjoyed his job. I found out that he was a 43-year-old man. He worked in a hospital by day. He was doing Uber at night to pay off med school bills. And the thing I latched onto, though, when I was talking to this guy was that he was 43, and he looked so young. And so I was curious, and I said, man, what's your secret? How do you, you know, keep your youthful looks? And he said, you know, I'll tell you. I learned this at the hospital from the doctors, but nobody usually believes me. But what I do is, every morning, I put Pepto-Bismol all over my face. And you guys are just silently looking at me like, that's not the weirdest thing. It's so fucking weird, you guys. And yeah, right? Yes, it's weird. And I was just like, oh my God, I just met a real life version of a one weird trick doctors don't want you to know at from the internet. Which is super exciting because now I know that I'm really close to meeting hot singles in my area. Yeah. Yeah, man. So, All right, maybe the Uber thing's not for me, right? All right, so I'll give you guys one other possibility I had. This is an invention I came up with, and I think this could be the thing that gets me out of the 9-to-5 life. And I'll tell you guys what it is, but I haven't patented this yet, so please don't steal my idea. But what it is it's a giant, wide-brimmed black hat to wear at funerals, and it's called the sombrero. You're gonna be at the office forever, huh? Yeah, I knew it. All right, well, what can you do, man? I don't know. Yeah, so it's the worst, man. And you know what? Like, I talk about it like I'm the nice guy and everybody else is the shitty person that I don't want to deal with. Like, I'm to blame a lot of the times, too. Like, I can be a douchebag, you know? I'll tell you a brief story from when I first started at my job. I was about a month in, and I used to have to work really closely with this woman named Karen. And Karen had been there for a long time before me. And so one day they call a meeting, and they say, hey, listen, the thing that you guys do together, we found a new way to do it. It's way more efficient, way better. It's gonna be great. Which is fine, except Karen had called out sick that day. So I'm the one who learned all this stuff, and now I have to be the guy to sit Karen down when she comes back and be like, all right, I gotta train you on this new process, but don't worry. I know everything. If you have any questions, you can come to me. We're gonna get through this together. Like, I felt like such a douchebag, you know? And I'm just dreading the day that Karen comes back when I have to deal with her, you know? So a couple of days go by and I'm sweating it. They call another meeting and I'm thinking, oh my God, how are they gonna make this worse for me? And so they sit us down in this meeting and they inform us that Karen had died the day before. Yeah, this is a 100% true story. She got pneumonia and she passed away. And my reaction to that was, whew! Oh my God, I just dodged a major bullet. Whew! So relieved. And this could be a good opportunity for me to sell some sombreros. So, I'm the bad guy too sometimes, you guys. Just, it sucks, man. So it's just the worst. You know, a good thing about my job, though, is that I did get a promotion not too long ago.
Congratulations.
Usually that at least gets a slight applause break. It's like, okay, congrats. Nope, it's too late. I'm not trying to pander, I'm just saying. Thank you for the congratulations. Because, like, I don't like my job, but I still want to do well at it, you know? Even if I worked at a gas station and I hated it, I'm still not going to sell beer to the man who's clearly 3 kids stacked inside of a trench coat, you know what I mean? So I get this promotion, and that's great, but the thing that sucked about it was that I had to train my replacement. And I don't know if you guys have ever had to, like, stand over someone's shoulder and guide them through using a computer when they're not good at using a computer. Has anyone had to go through that? It's torturous, isn't it, you guys? Like, the worst. I get so frustrated watching this person try to do this, and it's like, I'm watching and I'm like, okay, you gotta maximize this window, but the program's weird. You can't use the maximize button, so you're gonna have to click and drag the window. Just click it and drag the window. You know how the mouse goes, ch-ch-ch. Just do the ch part and drag it down. And just go, yeah, no, yeah, no, no, the corner of the window. You drag in the corner, no, 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 not that corner, not where the X is. Don't click the X. And as tears of blood are forming in my eyeballs, I had this epiphany, and I realized, oh my God, this is how women feel when I'm trying to unhook their bra. God, so, ladies, I'm sorry about that. Man, it's just such a sad story, isn't it? God. All right, I think you guys have heard enough sad stories from me for the evening, right? Oh, And guess what? That was my timer to let me know that my 10 minutes was up. So right on schedule, you guys. You guys ready for a show tonight? All right, cool. Your first performer coming to the stage, he's doing a little something different. He said, hey, you know, I'm not going to do strict stand-up tonight. I want to come on and do a character piece. So just so you guys are aware that a character is about to come and talk to you guys. Ladies and gentlemen, get ready for Mr. Barry Rosenblum, everybody.
Remember, my name's Fig Newton.
Good night, everybody.
Keep it going for Fake Newton, everybody. Oh my God, riboflavin is one of my favorite words. I love it. All right, that was great. Are you guys ready for your next comic? Come on, get enthused, you guys. You guys ready for your next comic? Yeah, your next comic coming to the stage. He's a good friend of mine. We perform together on a regular basis, and I always enjoy watching him do stand-up. Ladies and gentlemen, please give it up for Mr. Eddie Sage.
Well, how do you follow that, right? How you guys doing? My name is Eddie Sage, and this evening, I'm actually going to tell you a true story. Now, I don't often tell true stories on stage or in real life because I lie about a lot of stuff. But I don't like to think of them as lies so much as alternative truths, right? You guys are familiar with that concept, right? It's kind of like the truth, but it's not. But no, tonight, I will tell you a true story. Now, this particular yarn takes place in my college years, and I went to DeSales University, which is a small Catholic college named after St. Francis de Sales. And I know what you're thinking. St. Francis, he was the really cool one who could like talk to animals and like control them with his mind. But you'd be mistaken. There are actually two St. Francises. That one was St. Francis of Assisi. And despite the name, he was not a sissy. He was a total badass. The college St. Francis was St. Francis de Sales, who was famous for, you know, like nothing really, like ministry and charity and like other bullshit like that. And his saying was, be who you are and be that well, especially if you didn't do that well on your SATs and you now go to my college. So let me give you a little background about why I chose my alma mater. I chose DeSales because I only had the choice of either going to DeSales University or not going to college. So my hands were tied. And the reason for that is that I applied to only four schools. I wanted to be an actor, so I applied to acting schools. I applied to New York University, premier acting school. I applied to Ithaca University, one of the best acting schools in the country. I applied to Carnegie Mellon, one of the best acting schools in the world, and I applied to DeSales University, where my ex-girlfriend attended. I did not get in to any other schools than DeSales University, hence my tenure. Just to put that in perspective for you guys, that is the equivalent of going to a car dealership and being like, yeah, show me the Porsche, the Lamborghini, that Maserati, and that 82 Buick Roadmaster, knowing the entire time that your budget was a 2.1 GPA. And then that's what happened. So, I end up going to DeSales University. My ex-girlfriend goes there, and everything is going horrible. It's going really, really bad. I didn't finish my tenure at DeSales University, but I only dropped out two times. So, in you know, when you put that in perspective, not too shabby. I got half of a theater degree, which is about as useful as a whole theater degree. Because what you'll find is that a theater degree is not the most practical degree to get, because it's really only good for one thing, and that thing is being a waiter. You can't really take a theater degree and then go apply to be like a dentist. Like they'll be like, are you a dentist? You're like, no, but I could pretend to be pretty well, given enough rehearsal time and my magic if. A couple theater students in there? Yes. What are my pre-existing circumstances? If you didn't get that, fuck you. And you didn't go to theater school. So I go to DeSales University, and things are going badly, so we got that all in perspective. All right, so I'm living in an apartment with a few other gentlemen, and we decide to have a party. So, you know, we did this you know, like every night of the week. So we're having a party, and there's a bunch of people there, most of which I don't know, the rest of which I don't like, and things are going really great. Everybody is drinking a lot. I'm drinking a lot and doing a lot of drugs. And so, you know, it's a pretty great party. Included in that mix of people is Willie Wentz. Oh, how I hated Willie Wentz. Oh, I hated Willie Wentz to the umpth degree. One, his name. The alliteration on that, Willie Wentz. Ugh, it's horrible. Also, he was a big dick. Those two things were primarily why I hated Willie Wentz. His name and his demeanor. So, it comes to that point in the party where we're going to smoke some marijuana. So, I sort of retreat to my bedroom, including a few of my close friends, to, you know, go back and smoke some marijuana. And, you know, right on our foot tails entering the room, uninvited, yet attending, was Willie Wentz. And as he enters my room, he spills an entire solo cup of Busch Light beer on my Lucky Brand t-shirt. Which goes to show you how old this story was. I was wearing a Lucky Brand t-shirt. And it was cool at the time. And it was brand new. Hence, I was furious. Enraged. So I demand from Willie an apology. I say, hey, Willie, how about an apology? Willie says, Ed, you are a cheapskate and a fucking faggot. Perhaps the worst apology I have ever heard. Not a good apology at all. You are a cheapskate and a fucking faggot. A fucking faggot maybe, but a cheapskate? Nay. You are in my house, drinking my beer, about to smoke my marijuana in my room. None of those things lead to me being a cheapskate. So, I had no recourse but to assault Willie Wentz. So I rise from my seat and I punch Willie in the head as hard as I could. If any of you are feeling bad for Willie Wentz at this point in the story, just know karmatic justice has been served and I have been punched in the face a multitude of times, both before and after this story. So, feel better. So, I punch Willie Wentz, he falls on the ground. They kind of restrain me, people are trying to calm me down. Willie rises from his position on the ground, jumps over a group of my friends, and starts to fight with me, and we fight. Now, for those of you who have never been in a fight, it is really fast. It is not like what you see on TV. Unless you have two trained UFC fighters and or boxers, it looks like a lot more like two dudes having sex than it does two dudes fighting each other. It's usually like groping around on the ground, and it's kind of ugly. And so we get separated, and thankfully my friend, Big Dan, who is about 7 feet tall and maybe 310 pounds, aptly named, puts his shin on Willie Wentz's head, and then he kindly asks him to get the fuck out. To which Willie obliges, and he leaves. Great. Back to the party. And everybody's drinking and the smoking of the marijuana and the taking of the Xanax and we're having a great time. And hours pass. You know, the crowd dwindles. The lights dim. And we're settling in for the rest of the evening. And Dan and I, we venture to the living room to watch some television. And do my eyes deceive me? But there upon my sectional sleeping is Willie fucking Wentz, ladies and gentlemen. Sleeping on the sectional sofa that I purchased at Goodwill. Son of a bitch. So, I had no recourse but to cover Willie Wentz in tons of shit. I covered him in ranch dressing, in oregano, other spoiled condiments that were in my refrigerator. Pretty much anything and everything to ensure that the message would be heard and felt. So we did that and then we laughed a lot. And then we left. We kind of like dwindled again, time carries on, we go back out. Willie's gone, but the mess remains. There is crap all over my sectional couch. What to do, Big Dan, trusty sidekick? What shall we do with this mess? This couch is unusable, sir. And he's like, indeed, it just simply will not do. Let's take it outside to the dumpster. We'll dispose of it. Excellent idea. So we take the couch, we bring it out to the dumpster, but alas, the dumpster is full. Quite a predicament we found ourselves in. Ah, but an idea strikes me. Perhaps if we set the couch ablaze, it will become a small pile of ashes that will very handily go inside of the dumpster. Yes, yes indeed. This is a fabulous idea. Quick, to the accelerant. So we cover the couch in Axe body spray and bleach, which isn't flammable, but who the fuck, we didn't know what we were doing. So we cover it in this, we cover it in that, and we light the couch up, and it was the biggest fire I have ever seen in my life. The vision of how I thought this couch would burn was nothing like it actually burned. It blazed with the fires of 1,000 suns. It was so large. And the lady walking her dog at 7:30 in the morning noticed that we had started this giant fire and proceeded to call the police, who arrived toot sweet in quick fashion. These same gentlemen had arrested me not 2 weeks prior for incidents not as funny and not not going to be repeated. So they said, Ed, didn't we say that we never wanted to see you again? And I said, yes. And they said, so why are we here? And I said, I don't know. You know, being coy. They're like, you don't know? And I was like, all right, maybe I do know. And they're like, what made you think that you could do this? To which I responded, I'm from Delaware, and everybody there does shit like this. Thank you, guys. That's my time. Have a good night.
Keep it going for Eddie Sage, everybody. I punched him in the face one time. But it was like in Batman vs. Superman, where he just keeps punching him and nothing happens. He's like way bigger than me. So those lights flicker when you tell a lie. I don't know. I don't know what it is. All right, you guys ready for your next comic? I need more enthusiasm. Come on, you guys. Are you guys ready for your next comic? Ah, yes. Your next comic coming to the stage is another good friend of mine. I owe a lot to this guy. He is one of the head honchos. Please give it up for Mr. Casey Kasperson.
What instrument is that? What instrument is that? I think that's a thing that they put on the thing and they spin the thing. Does anyone know what the name of that is? That someone made that noise one time. They're like, that's got to be part of the drums, Bill. I don't know. What's up, guys? How are you? Good. Good, good, good. Thanks so much for coming out tonight. Coming to our Dr. Seuss show, apparently. So, man, I'm fat, huh? Blame my father mostly. You might have met him. His name's Papa John. It's a good joke. I've been using it for about 20 years. So, oh, fuck. So, I've been with my wife for 18 years, yeah? I am looking for applause, by the way. Thank you. And it's a weird thing, because when you've been with somebody for 18 years, just keep in mind that I also lived with my parents for 18 years and celebrated when I could move away from them. And that is not the case in marriage. After 18 years, you get to stay. And I wish they would have told me that the day I got married. I just thought new shit happens every 18 years. You just gotta retread. But we made more people, so that's that happened.
No, we don't applaud that.
That's It's a bad thing, you know, but I've been with, really, I mean, first of all, look how I'm dressed. I had no choice but to have kids. You dress like this and you're gonna get somebody pregnant. Not because they are attracted to you, but they're just like, that guy probably has a $45,000 salary and can take care of me because he has certain insurances that make me feel complacent with myself, you know? So my wife settled, is what I'm saying. She settled down to me and I tricked her. So that's the thing that happened. But a lot of people, they always ask, they're like, man, 18 years, how do you do it? I'm like, don't talk to each other. And I really mean that. Don't talk to each other ever. Because, and think about it this way. By round of applause, who's been to see a psychologist before? And those extra people that applauded that didn't, that made the other people feel better, give yourselves another round of applause. That's nice. You guys are a supportive audience. Psychologists make all of their money the more you talk. Think about how many sessions you would have with your spouse if you didn't say shit on the first meeting. Like, how's everything going? And you both were like, good. Looks like we're fucking done here. No, psychologists love drama. They tell you that they're fixing you, but by round of applause, who went to a final psychologist session and was like, done? Exactly. Right, because they're like, oh, let's meet next week. And you sit with them and you're like, yeah, my wife. We aren't having as much sex as we would like to have, as I would like to have. And she also leaves the dishes for me to always clean, and that's on me. And here's what the psychologist says. Bring her in here. I want to talk to her. So you do it, which is stupid. So you bring her in, and then she talks one-on-one with the bitch. I don't have anyone in mind, but her office is across the street. And so I don't know what goes on in that session, but there's only one person that knows both sides of the story. And then she's like, we should do a dual session together. And you're like, okay, because you're the expert. And then you get there, and then she unleashes all the shit that you've said about each other while you're both there. That's horrible. There's no other place where saying what's on your mind works. By round of applause, whose office or job has a open door policy? Yeah. You ever noticed who takes advantage of the open door policy gets fired? I have an open door policy. We're just really open for new ideas here. That's just a thing that we have. And then you go give an idea, and then 2 weeks later they're like, oh man, we're downsizing by one. Because nobody wants to hear that, like, they suck. Because an open door policy is you going in and saying, this thing that you're doing currently in your business is not as good as my idea, and I would like to usurp you. And then they, even though they claim they have an open door policy, will say something like, Casey, stop drinking on the job. You know what I mean? Something general like that. You know, nothing. That's happened to everybody, right? Fuck. And it's weird, too, because we all have issues with everybody in our relationship. By round of applause, who's in a relationship right now? So just leave each other alone. You know, like if someone drinks a little bit too much in the relationship, if they're not drinking and driving, if they're not a dickhead while they're drunk, you just don't like the idea that they're drinking. Just shut up, you know? And just thank you. Was that Bruce clapping? Thank you, Bruce. Man. I feel like some of the things I'm saying are specific to me and not necessarily advice for everybody else, but that's okay. You guys are cheap therapy. Oh, I could use a Fig Newton. When I was a kid, who heard that figs had maggots in them? Okay. Okay, my mom has a thing about maggots. I have a whole story about maggots that I'm not sharing tonight. But my mom, to get me to stop eating so many Fig Newtons because I loved them, told me that there were maggot eggs and that's what crunched. I did not slow down eating Fig Newtons. So I didn't know what a maggot was at the time. They didn't have the internet and I didn't know where to find an encyclopedia. I was six. That's fucked up. My mom is like, my mom's crazy because we're, first of all, let me back up. My mom's great, okay? We're recording this and she might watch it, so love you so much. But she's crazy as shit. And the reason is that like my mom is that person you never want to have a discussion with because she always wants to be on the other side, you know? She always wants to play the devil's advocate. So when you're having a shit day, go to my mom. I got fired from my job because I was drinking on the job. And my mom would be like, you're my baby boy, and you're so beautiful, and you're lovely, and I love you so much, and everything that you've done is wonderful, and the world doesn't understand that you're just the pretty flower, and you're the prettiest flower that's ever lived on this earth. I love you so much, and you're capable of so many things, and you're my baby boy. That's my mom. However, if you give her good news, like the day we found out we were having a baby, my mom was like, oh, that's so great. But is now really a good time? I mean, with the economy and everything, and you're in comedy, so. That's fucked up. You can't like be like, oh, you know what? You're right, mom, let's return it. You know? So, anyway, the bottom line is this, that another way to keep your marriage together is to have kids. A lot of times people say don't have kids to keep a marriage together. I say have kids because they distract you by how much you hate your spouse. And there's a good 18 years of just being on the same team. It's like I figure being in the army and hating your drill sergeant, but when you go to combat, you are on the same team while you're fighting the enemy, and the enemy is a six-year-old and a three-year-old that still shits his pants. It's Friday night. I have left my wife with my two children. And I'll be here tomorrow night as well. Am I out of time, Ben?
Yeah.
Great, thank you. My name's Casey Kasperson. This is Sick Puppies Comedy. Thank you so much.
Keep it going for Casey, everybody. He's very happy with his life. All right, come on, he's making fun of himself. Are you guys ready for your next comic? All right. You should be excited for this next comic. He's here all the way from Miami. This guy's very funny. He runs the Key Party Show down at Just the Funny Theater, which is a great place to go if you're ever in Miami. And he's pretty great, too. Ladies and gentlemen, please give it up for Joe Nay.
Greatness because he's doing everything that a celebrity comic does.
He's on stage, he's on podcasts, he's on Twitter, he's on drugs, and eventually on trial. I like how you introduced me, Beth, but next time if you could also credit me with the Gotham Comedy Club in New York and the Laugh Factory in L.A., because I have visited both of those website pages. I am happy for the little things in life, such as a microphone. The last show I was at, they didn't have a mic for me, so it felt weird. I had to pretend to have one. An improv mic, which worked out great up until the time I was mid-joke and somebody took a picture and posted it on Facebook. My wife was very upset about that picture, but I did double the number of hits on my Grindr account. Hope everybody had a great holiday. I had a wonderful Hanukkah this year. I have this tradition at Hanukkah that in every room of the house, I put a different size menorah. And under each menorah, I put a different colored cloth. My family tells me I'm really weird for doing that because I'm not Jewish. Yeah. This is my first time performing here as a stand-up comic, so I'll tell you a little bit about myself. I was born in Battle Creek, Michigan. Some of you may know that, that's funny to somebody, you must be from Ohio. You may know Battle Creek as the cereal capital of the world because it's home to both Kellogg's and Post cereals. Our high school mascot was a flake. We could never count on him. In high school, I was on the chess team and on the football team. I think the hardest part about being both a jock and a nerd at the same time was having to give myself wedgies. Even though I was born in Michigan, I grew up in Columbus, Ohio, home of Ohio State University. One of my fondest memories as a kid was halftime at the football games when the marching band, Ohio State marching band, would come out and spell the big curse of Ohio. I understand Florida State wants to do the same thing. If they finally enroll enough students that know how to spell. I know by saying that joke, I made the Seminole fans in the audience angry. I made the Gator fans happy. And I made the Hurricane fans ask their neighbor to explain the joke. I sent away from one of those DNA kits from Ancestry.com because I wanted to know where in the world I came from. So I got my blood sample and sent it to them, and the results that came back were pretty surprising. I'm 30% Icelandic, 40% Slavic, and 100% diabetic. When I first got into comedy, my results were kind of inconclusive. I couldn't tell if I was getting a reaction from the audience. The very first joke I told was about Malaysian Flight 370, and to this day, I still don't know if it landed. In the season finale of Last Comic Standing, one of the judges says it takes up to 30 years to become a good comic. I started 2 years ago when I was 55. So by the time I'm 85, I'm going to be killing it at the 4 p.m. dinner show at the Shady Pines retirement home. But in that age category, Last Comic Standing takes on a much darker meaning. My family was questioning why I would want to get into comedy at such an advanced age. All my pop culture references are from the 1970s. Well, I get that, but I'm doing this for you guys. I want you to want me. I need you to need me. I'd love you to love me. Sorry guys, that was a cheap trick. I never could understand why the village people saying that they like to go to the YMCA. I've been to the YMCA. It's depressing. But now it all makes sense. In this month's People magazine, they said that the lead singer for the Village People was dyslexic. They just like shopping at Macy's. Two, three, four, eight, come on without that one. huge fight with my brothers. And they were in my room, they picked up my 8-track tape collection of all my favorite rock bands and started tossing them at me. That's when I found out that the saying was true, that sticks and the stones can break your bones. You have to be my age or older to get the reference for that joke. Yeah. I have one of these self-activated, voice-activated self-driving cars. Last week I said, drive to Orlando. Then I put my iTunes on and took a nap. When I woke up, I was in Birmingham. I should have known better than to put Sweet Home Alabama on my playlist. That's okay, I'm just glad I woke up before I played Highway to Hell. I had my personal identity stolen. I haven't reported it yet, though. My credit was so bad, the thief is actually improving it. I went to the bank this morning. I told them I wanted to pay a bill from my account using an electronic funds transfer. They said, I'm sorry, Mr. Nay, you can't use an EFT because your account has nothing LEFT. Which I wouldn't have minded so much, except when the bank manager said that, he emphasized the L like this. Which I thought was pretty ballsy of him, because I could have taken this to be flashing a gang sign, and obviously I'm gangsta. And then I would have to throw down on him to protect my street cred. And by street, I mean Wall Street. I'm going to have to stop right here for a minute. This has been bothering me the whole time I've been up here. Sir, I finally figured out who you remind me of. There's a show on TV called America's Top Male Model. You remind me the type of guy that would watch that show. Yeah. No, you're very handsome. You could be on that show. What is your name?
My name is Dan.
Dan. You're from right here in Boca?
Yes, I am.
Dan from, okay. I promise I will only make fun of you one more time tonight.
We'll be the last.
I had a pretty good job right out of school. I was a software developer. Then I became a middle manager. Now I'm trying to become a comic. Seems like I'm on the Benjamin Button career path. If you guys don't laugh at me tonight, next week when you come here, you'll see me out on Camino Real with a sick puppy sign. And then at the very end, I'll hit rock bottom and become Dan from Boca. See, I ripped the band-aid right off. I did it right away. Now you can enjoy the rest of my set. I went to, this is an improv stage. Let me try an improv and work that into one of my jokes. From anyone in the audience, give me, let's say, a day of the week.
Thursday.
Thursday, okay. Last Thursday, I went to the Outback Steakhouse. See how I subtly worked that in? They have gift shops now. Some of them have gift shops. So I was looking in there, and they had a boomerang. I've never owned one, so I wasn't sure how to work it. I asked the sales girl, what happens if I throw it and it doesn't come back to me? She says, well, if it doesn't return, you can return it. Which I said, wow, that sounds like a paradox. She said, I'm not really Australian. A paradox, is that like a dingo or a wallaby? It was just then that I realized that she probably got her job by going down under. At one point in my life, I had an Australian girlfriend. It's pretty much the same as having a girlfriend from the Northern Hemisphere. Except I go down on her counterclockwise. My wife was born in a different country. She has these clever ways of trying to teach me about other countries. For example, she named her breasts Trinidad and Tobago. And that's how I remember, and I'll never forget always that Trinidad is the much larger one. And that's the one where all the business gets done. That's where she nursed from. Tobago is mostly for recreation. That's the one I'm allowed to play with. I'd only tried a dating service one time in my life. I told him I was expecting to find a woman that was successful, intelligent, liked sports, and was humorous. So I wrote up my bio and I handed it to them and asked them if I needed to change anything. They said, yes, your expectations. Yeah. I was talking with a woman at the bar down the street. I think she was really into herself because the very first question she asked me was on a scale of 1 to 100, how hot I thought she was. So I told her, 98.6. Which I thought was pretty high, you know, but she wanted it to be even higher. I said, well, maybe you'll get the flu. I pulled in up to an intersection on the way here. A man came up to my car holding his hand out. Looks like he was homeless, so I took a dollar out of my wallet and rolled the window down. It was just then I saw that he was holding a sign. It says, this could be you someday. And I thought about it, you know, he's right. I better hold on to my dollar. I recently became a member of the Mile High Club. Accidentally. The airline bathrooms are so small and I'm so large that when we hit some turbulence, I became intimate with the soap dispenser. I call her Bubbles. Not much on personality, but she is self-lubricating. So I guess that's a wash. Because of that incident, Virgin Airlines will now have to change their name. I was at a cocktail party. A woman I hadn't even met yet came over and started rubbing my big belly. She asked me if it worked like a Buddha statue where she could make a wish. I told her I would be much more likely to grant her wish if she rubbed lower. Because my feet were really hurting. Medicine is so expensive these days. On this last prescription, I ordered it online from overseas to save some money. But when they got it, it wasn't working. I did some research and found out that a high percentage of pills from overseas are actually, they don't contain medicine. They contain drywall materials. So I stopped using it, of course, except recreationally when I wanted to get plastered. It was supposed to be Viagra, but the only thing I could erect with it was a house. Thank you very much, everybody.
Keep it going for Joe, everybody. So, way adjust the mic stand for myself after Joe finishes. All right, man. You guys ready for your next comic? Yeah. Yeah. I don't know what that was. I just felt like doing that. But now I feel weird about it, so I have to ask you again. Are you guys ready for your next comic? Okay, cool. Thank you. Your next comic coming to the stage, he's a very funny guy. He's one of my favorite comics to watch in Florida, man. He's part of the degenerates of comedy. Ladies and gentlemen, please give it up for Nico Prada.
Thanks. One of the degenerates of life, actually. I'm part of what the degenerate comedy crew, what we do. I can't see you guys, but I can already tell you. Kind of get a little upset, but that's all right. You'll like it by the end of the joke. That's usually what happens, really. I've caught a Marcel before, and I'm like, ah, shit. You were funny. I just got Windows 10 on my computer. I didn't want to get Windows 10. It installed itself. I don't know how. I just kind of woke up one day, and it kind of Brock Turnered itself into my system. So that he's a rapist, if you know. But that wasn't bad enough. I didn't want to get it because I'm not technology savvy. I was just getting used to Windows 9. I don't know what the fuck the last one was. But I'm not. Here's a problem I have with Windows 10. They have their own version of Siri. And do you guys use Siri at all?
Yeah.
I love Siri. I use her for everything. I'll probably use her tonight. I'll be like, hey Siri, are there any DUI roadblocks I should avoid on the ride home? Then she'll be like, you took an Uber here, dumb fuck. This isn't even your car. Get out. Get a DUI for not driving a car that's not yours. They'll do that. If they want to be dicks about it, they'll do that. They call it intent to drive. Like, they can read your mind or some shit. They'll give you a DUI, $10,000 right there. And I'll go, thanks, Siri. But, Windows 10... Windows 10 has their own version of Siri, and I just don't trust it, because it's called Cortana. And it sounds a little bit too dominatrixy to me. You know, like a weird Eastern European mail order bride type thing. Maybe it's because I'm an uncultured swine, as I've been called before. But, okay, here's the thing. There's a search bar at the bottom of the desktop, and it says, I'm Cortana, ask me anything. But I read it as, I'm Cortana, ask me anything. It just sounds like a trap, you know? Like, I'll be like, all right, Cortana, can I go on Netflix now? She's like, no, you're a bad boy. Get on your knees, biggie. I spank you now. What? Yeah, you don't even pay for Netflix. Only good boys go on Netflix. You don't pay for Netflix. You use your friend Joe DeWayne's passport. I shove my panties in your mouth. Fuck, right, I'm sorry, Cortana. Like, don't apologize to me, apologize to Joe DeWayne. It's his fucking account that you use, all right? He gave you password like 2 years ago so you could watch documentary, and you still use the account, and you haven't even watched documentary yet, all right? You're not even bad boy, you're kind of piece of shit friend at this point. I fist you now, ah! Wait, I'm sorry, Joe DeWayne. I'm sorry. No, you sound like you're mean, Biggie. I'm sorry, Joe DeWayne. I'm sorry for the Netflix thing, and I'm sorry that I didn't bring beer to your birthday party. All right, I was kind of broke at the time. I brought that bottle of whiskey, so it would look like I brought something to the party so I could contribute, even though I knew I was going to be the only one drinking it, all right? I'm sorry, Cortana. Is that good enough for you? Can I finish watching Sons of Anarchy now? I was like, yes, ask me anything. Hey, man. I'm afraid to watch porn on my own computer. And then Cortana's gonna find out. What is this? No, Debbie does what? Debbie does who? No. You don't need Lisa Ann in your life, you have Cortana. All you need is her. You want to have threesome fantasy, you do with Cortana's friend, a Krushnikova. I shove my fucking piss on your face. Fuck! Siri, help! No, Siri fell downstairs. It was an accident. I need to dump Cortana, man. I'm gonna switch to Well Liquor and 305 cigarettes for a month so I can actually save up to buy a Macintosh that actually understands that sometimes a guy just wants to snuggle all day on a Sunday afternoon, having shameless, painless, chainless sex where it's okay to make eye contact. The only safety word you need is ouch. Right? Or watching reruns of Chappelle's Show and drinking Bloody Marys in between fucks. Is that too much to ask for, Cortana? Is that too much? Probably not, but with a name like that, I'm not gonna trust it. Yeah. I love Bloody Marys. I do. If this place had a bar, I'd be drinking one right now. I used to hate Bloody Marys until I tried one. Yeah. I did a show not too long ago in Boynton Beach. And I ordered a Bloody Mary at night because my hangovers last that long. And I said, can I please get a Bloody Mary to the bartender? And she goes, yes, you can, but it's not going to have any vodka in it because we don't have a liquor license. I go, well, then the answer to that question should have been no. What the fuck is a Bloody Mary without vodka? If I was going to order a tomato bisque on the rocks, I would have said so, but I didn't. You know why? For the same reason nobody ever has, nobody ever will. It's fucking disgusting. I didn't say that, obviously. I know she's just doing her job and I'm respectful to bar staff. But what the fuck is a Bloody Mary without vodka in it? It's nothing. Like, if you order a book online and they just sent you a stack of blank pages in the mail, they go, sorry, we don't have a printer, just don't fucking send it then. Don't send that shit to me. But here's the thing about a Bloody Mary without vodka in them. I hate tomato juice and I hate vodka. Unless they're in the same cup, mixed together with like 8 other ingredients you wouldn't mix in 1,000 years. Like, the ingredients to a Bloody Mary are like genitals. They're disgusting on their own, but you put them together and you're in heaven. Really. Which leads me lead to believe that the first Bloody Mary ever drank had to have been a suicide attempt. Because there's no way that somebody without knowing what the magical effects of a Bloody Mary to a hangover would put that shit in their stomach and not think that they were gonna die. Like, I could just picture this guy waking up with the gnarliest hangover of his life going, all right, fuck this. I'm not even gonna try to Gatorade myself out of this one. I'm just gonna put vodka and tomato juice in the same cup to kill myself because my garage door won't close and my car is not running. And you know what? I'm gonna put Worcester sauce in there and fucking horseradish and salt and pepper, and I'm gonna put Tabasco in there just to make the explosion real spicy for the CSI. Like, you know what? I'm gonna stir it with a celery stick because fuck you and fuck me and fuck the world. Good night. Gosh, that's actually really tasty. I kind of don't want to die anymore, really. If only there was a way I could reverse the effects of this concoction. All I got left in my fridge is champagne and orange juice. That's the birth of guilty day drinking. It is. Yeah. I try to write my jokes on my hand so you can't tell that I'm looking at them, but I'm fucking doing it. I don't care. They don't have booze here. I can do this. It's fucking terrifying doing this sober review. Well, that's all right. Yeah. I listen to a lot of music on YouTube, and music specifically because it's like I do like the playlist, like a full playlist. It's Pandora is cool, but they switch artists every time. I like to listen to the same artists. Like, that's why I go on YouTube. Like, you try to listen Dark Side of the Moon the whole fucking way through. You guys know what I'm talking about?
Yeah.
Yeah, you can't just listen to one song in Dark Side of the Moon. That's the terrorists, dude. And then I do it on YouTube because it's free. And it's great that it's free because of the ads, but I don't see why anybody would want to advertise their product on YouTube. Because it's not like TV commercials where they go, oh, we'll be right back, go to the bathroom and drink another beer. No, they just interrupt you right in the middle of the words free and bird. They just fucking throw in a commercial. Nissan, I'm not buying Nissan. That doesn't make me want to buy your product. I hate you at that point. Really. Like, I end up buying brands I've never heard of before because that's not the asshole who made me listen to Watch Me Nae Nae in between Pantera songs. And at the same time, it's shit that doesn't even really need to be advertised. It's like fucking Charmin Ultra, really. Like, I know I need better toilet paper, all right? I poop every day. I need that stuff. Or fucking Axe Body Spray, Double Pits to Chesty, or whatever their fucking slogan is. I'm not on YouTube going, like, shopping for bathroom supply. Right? You know why I'm on YouTube? I'm listening to the Lord of the Rings soundtrack at work. Because it makes my job feel epic. And you should, too. You should, even if you have the most boring office job where you're filing tax forms or something like that, play the fucking 007 theme, right? At that point, you're not filing tax forms, you're gathering government intel, right? You're a spy. Do you deliver pizza or food or some kind of Chinese shit? Or play the Godfather theme while you're on delivery. Think about it, you got this guy's name, address, and where he likes to eat the most. You're not a delivery boy, you're a hitman. That point, it'll make your job exciting, you know. And you know, I'm not saying work a job you hate and sugarcoat it with movie soundtracks. That's an awful way to live your life. But work is work, no matter what you do. Even if you love your job, I love my job. I still listen to Lord of the Rings. Even if you love your job, work is work. I guarantee you, even the porn stars without daddy issues wake up cranky on a Monday morning. The ones that actually just love to fuck on camera and there's no daddy issues or trying to degrade themselves or really no. You're gonna tell me that Gianna Michaels deep down inside has resentment for what she does? Really, that's bullshit, because I've seen deep down inside Gianna Michaels. Right. There was no empty seat at the ballet recital where daddy should have been. There was no resentment. There's just fucking wetness and happiness. And that's fine. That's fine if that's what she wants to do, but I guarantee you, even she looks forward to a long weekend. So, yeah, I yeah, I use Lord of the Rings at my job because I'm a carpenter. I do custom woodwork, and Lord of the Rings just seems to fit. Like, you see me working, it might look like I'm building you a bookshelf, but not up here. All right, I'm here. I'm getting ready to go to war against the forces of Mordor right now. All right, I'm building trebuchets and catapults, and I'm strapping on shields and shit like that. You think I'm sanding a piece of oak right now? No, I'm sharpening up my sword because I'm ready to chop some fucking heads off right now. All right, I'm excited. My adrenaline's going through. It's going like fucking crazy. I've been in 2 fights in my life. I've lost 1.5 of them, but not this one. This one I'm gonna fucking win. This one I'm gonna jump the fucking orc's head off right now. And I'm excited. My work day's going by like a breeze. My boss walks by and goes, I go, strength and honor, General Maximus. And he's confused. He doesn't really give a shit because I'm working like my life depends on it. And it technically does. And I understand that I just mix up Lord of the Rings and Gladiator in the same joke, but that's not the point. The point is, there is a time when man and elf shall fight and die together, and that time is now, motherfucker, because there are orcs coming, all right? Not just orcs, these are Uruk-hai. They're fucking, and I'm excited, I'm ready to fucking go to war, I've chopped some heads off. I don't want to hear about how dirty boys get clean. Axe body spray or body wash. You're ruining my fucking thing. Every single one of those commercials should just be, hey, free music, thanks to Axe Body Spray, free Lord of the Rings. And I'll go, oh, thanks, Axe Body Spray. Next time I go to Publix, I'll actually check out your product. I'll smell like a prepubescent teenager who thinks Blink-182 is the most hardcore punk band there is out there. But at least the music is free, and I would actually do that. But no, instead this is interrupt my epic adventure, so fuck you, I'm sticking with Old Spice. What I'm doing. At this point I would take a sip of my drink, but I haven't in here. I can't exactly do what I usually do, where I just fucking sneak whiskey into concerts and the empty Skittles bags that I seal off with a Zippo and tape them out of my leg like a junkie on probation. Can't do that. No, but like I said, I am a carpenter. That's my other job, the one that pays me money. And right now, it's a mother-son company. It's just my dad and I. We do custom woodwork. We want a card after the show. By all means, ask me. But we're doing this closet right now for this couple, and like any other client, they're going like, it's taking too long, where's our closet, which normally I would understand because clients don't understand custom woodwork. We don't just like go to the closet tree and get one and bring it to your house. We have to actually buy the wood, we have to cut the wood, we have to stain the wood, we have to wait for that to dry, then we have to finish the wood, and it's a long fucking process, is what I'm saying. But they don't, most clients don't realize that, but they're going, where's our closet? And normally I would understand, sympathize, but this is a gay couple. Why the fuck are you so eager to get back into a closet right now? Like, you would think those are some pretty dark times that you don't want to relive. Like, why would you do that? I guarantee you Rosa Parks never rode the back of a bus after the shit that happened to her, you know? Like, why are you trying to get back in the closet? I'm hoping they're trying to get revenge on the closet or something like that. And they're like, hey, what's up, closet? Remember me? You made me feel oppressed for being a homosexual? But guess what? I'm gonna fill you with bedazzled shirts and assless chaps, bitch. Looks like you better pray the gay away now because I own this house, motherfucker. Just hoping they do that. Just going to, like, with a big black dildo like Motley Crue in a hotel room, fuck shit up. I don't care if they break it, because if I can hate homophobia, and I'm all for equal rights for everybody, including gays, including the homos. I know that's a shitty way to say it, but it's just the way. And if there's any gay people in the crowd here tonight, and you're not open about it, just know that me and everybody on my Facebook feed has your fucking back. So just fuck the closet. Just don't try to fuck me. That's a stupid thing to say. But it's part of the joke. It is. Because is that not the most ignorant thing people say about homosexuals? Like, I don't mind the gays as long as they're trying to fuck me. And it's always somebody who is not even remotely close to getting hit on by a gay guy. Like, this guy gets spiked the soap in the prison shower. Like, he just scored a touchdown. Bend over to pick it up, the biggest rapist in there will be like, can we just be friends? Yeah. Like, remove a little quick. Like, and one of the gays, like I said, trying to fuck me. You'll be fine, Cletus. Okay? Yeah, I understand having no teeth technically makes you better at blowjobs, but nobody's gonna try to fuck you in the mouth. Alright, you'll be fine. I don't know if you've left the meth lab in the past 50 years, but the gays have a bit of a sense of fashion. Alright, you'll bring an overall and their shirt underneath. You'll be fine. Another one I've heard is, this was my mom. Don't tell her I said this. She goes, I think it's good that the gays can marry, but I don't think they should be able to adopt. Because now the child doesn't have a choice what family it's going into. As if any child had a choice what family they were going into, adopted or not. They don't even have a choice what family they were going into. And even if you didn't have that choice, when would you have that choice? Like when you're a sperm or something? Like you're talking to a travel agent? I want this one. No, I don't want, not the fag one. You know? And even if you did have that choice when you were a sperm, think about this. When you're a sperm during the act of conception, You're participating in the most important race of your entire life. You're going up against millions of other contestants. There can only be one winner. And if you don't win, you die. The most horrible, humiliating death, right? You get queefed onto a sock. Or you get killed by a feminine hygiene product. Death by douche on your gravestone forever. That's the legacy you leave on this planet. You really think if you make it to the finish line, you're gonna stop and be like, whoa, wait a minute, show me the Carfax. Alright? We don't wanna end up with no faggot family. No. You would fucking take that trophy like the gay trophy that it is. Put it up on your mantle. Am I wrong? I'm not gay myself, though. Although I support the gay, people ask me, you ever done anything gay? I mean, other than making out with a man in front of Westboro, I don't know. I did, it wasn't Westboro, but it was that weird fucking, like, giant cross people in Bourbon Street in New Orleans. You guys remember that? That's all right. I didn't really need a response for that one. But other than that, like, they go, so, have you actually done, like, tried anything gay? And the answer is, I don't know, honestly, because... it's because I was raised Catholic, and it's not a cheesy priest joke or anything like that. I didn't get molested or shit like that. It's because when you're Catholic, you know, we go to Mass every Sunday, and at the end of Mass, we split the body of Jesus among all the churchgoers. You know, we're splitting the Eucharist, which means at least one person there had to get his penis. And I just don't know if I was one of them, you know? So there's a big chance that I blew our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. Because I don't chew the Eucharist, I stick it through the roof of my mouth and I go at it with my tongue until it's finished and I swallow. So, yeah, if that's the case, I better get into heaven. Then, you know, if anyone had a relationship with the Lord, it's fucking this guy right here. Like, I can only hope that when I die and I'm at the pearly gates and St. Peter's telling me, like, dude, with all the fucking things you did, there's no way you're getting into heaven with all the sinning and cussing and drug use and... with all the fucking comedy shows you did and places with a target on your back. No, there's no way you're getting in. When you were 14, you spent your Christmas money on mushrooms. No, there's no way you're getting into heaven. I can only hope that right as he's about to pull the lever to send me to hell, Jesus is back there going, hey, Pete, let him in. He's cool. He's with me, all right? He did me a favor in the past. Don't tell my dad. So one can hope for. No, I'm lying. I don't have a Jeebus. In case you don't hate me already, I am an atheist, a dirty, filthy atheist. But people have a big misconception about atheists. Here's the thing, I'm not a douchey atheist. I don't go around saying that there's no God. I have no idea if there's a God. Believe it or not, that's not what atheist means. I know a lot of these people that call themselves atheists are out there doing that. Trust me, I hate them as much as you do, because they piss you off and they make me look like a dick. Alright? Atheist just means a rejection of a belief. That doesn't mean you believe that belief is false. You know what I'm saying? You can be agnostic and atheist at the same time. I don't believe that right now my granny is in Bogota, Colombia, taking Jaeger bombs and motorboating strippers. Do I know for sure that she's not? No. I don't believe that she's not. I mean, it seems highly unlikely, and until further evidence is presented to me, I'm simply not going to worry about it. That's how I feel about religion, alright? I'm not one of those douchebags that goes around saying that there's no God. I don't know if there's no God. But people have a big misconception about atheists because, they think we can't have morals because we don't have a book telling us what to do. There's no Bible or Quran to atheism. There's no, like, and thus spoke with Carl Sagan Tuesday's taco night. Like, we don't have that. So people go, how could you possibly have morals if you're an atheist? You don't have a book telling you what to do. And that's kind of like telling somebody who doesn't like to listen to the Beatles, how could you possibly let it be when you find yourself in times of trouble? If you don't have the Beatles telling you how to think, you go, I don't fucking know. Analyze the situation. Maybe you should let it be. Maybe you shouldn't let it be. Maybe if you find yourself in times of trouble because you're getting sucked out to the ocean by a rip current, don't let it be. Fucking swim sideways. It's not that complicated. But they go, oh, you atheists. That's what they call us. You atheists. You just hate the Beatles. Why do you hate the Beatles? And we don't hate the Beatles. We just don't like to listen to them. And we think it makes no sense to live in a yellow submarine. That's it. It's rational to us. But they go, oh, you, what's wrong with the Beatles? They're a band of love. They just came to teach love. Like, have you read the scriptures? From fucking Rubber Soul 316, the book of John Lennon? The song Run For Your Life starts out with the words, I'd rather see you dead, little girl, than to be with another man. Does that sound like a loving band to you? And they go, well, that's the old Beatles. You gotta listen to the new Beatles. It's all the fucking Beatles, man. It's just like the Testaments. And they go, well, you just want to get the Beatles taken out of the public education system. No, we don't. Just teach them in the music classroom. You can't teach the Beatles in the science classroom and expect that to be okay. You can't teach kids that they can live under the sea in an octopus garden. Humans can't breathe underwater. And then they go, yeah, you can. All you need is love, right? I'm fucking done talking to you. And I'm done talking to you guys, too. Thank you.
Keep it going for Nico Prada, everybody. I love that Beatles joke, man. Also, I literally file tax forms at my job, so I'm going to be playing the 007 theme. Are you guys ready for your last comic? You guys ready for your headliner? Are you guys ready? Do my weird shit. Okay. Your last comic coming to the stage. He is a very funny man. I quite enjoy watching him perform. You can find him performing not just all around Florida, he's performing all around the country now. Ladies and gentlemen, give it up for Hennessy Williams III.
Oh. Hi. I feel like I'm being interrogated. Just this light, like this light makes me feel like I need to tell all my friends right about now. You understand, your officer, I was not there that evening. I'm a fat man, I didn't rob the bank. It's okay to laugh at me being big, y'all. It's insane. I'll give you a little factoid about me. The reason why this light is bothering me so much is because I smoked weed. Earlier. That's it. I gotta be honest. I gotta tell the truth. It's really the truth. So like I can't see shit. I know there's like young girls, cause there's like a young girl laughter in this general area. Like cause young girls laugh a certain way that you always like that's young people laugh. Like if you get a little older, sometimes you laugh. There's a little experience in there. Like you've earned that laugh. Like the more hearty, you don't give them out more as much as when you was younger. I miss that. That was the one thing, like if you date, like when you dated and you were like 19, 20 years old, everything was hilarious. Like anything you said to your girlfriend, you flip your eyelids inside out like a fourth grader. Ah, and she's like, that's hilarious and gross, stop. Once you get like a little bit early, like older in your 30s and stuff, you try to flip your eyelids, your girl's like, I need to break up with you. You can't be this old. I'm trying to talk to you about getting a CD together, and you've got your eyelids flipped open. What's up, buddy? Yeah, you. How you doing? You good? All right, cool. I just wanted to make sure you personally were okay. I don't give a fuck about anybody else in this room. Not even the couple that's about to have sex right now. Like, they're this close to fucking there. Yeah, I mean, it's real nice on that side of the room. This dude is, you guys got matching sandals. Like in his and her set at night. That's like, I like that. That's a level of comfort I want. Like, I keep going after these young hood rat girls, and you gotta have nice shoes on. I need to start getting me a chick that doesn't give a fuck about sandals. Like, you just have sandals out in public and just be comfortable. I envy you, sir. My youth is a cage. And what's really crazy is, like, I'm not actually, like, really young in spirit, because I'm, like, 27, I'm black, and I'm overweight. So I'm, like, middle-aged. Basically, you know what I'm saying? Like, I should have the freedom you have. I should be like, fuck you guys, I'm gonna die soon. I'm gonna start wearing sandals. I don't give a shit to these tight ass shoes. Walking around looking like a Tic Tac. Shit sucks. How long y'all been together? Ooh. No, she should always answer. Don't ever answer. The only reason is because you might not be on the same page when you decide to not have sex with other people. I've seen it happen, like where people didn't agree on the same time scale. You're not answering. Are you guys still not really together? What is happening? Why'd you look into his eyes like that? You gazed into his eyes when I said, are you guys really together? And you're like, you had to take inventory for a minute. Like, you actually sat there and had to have a conscious discussion with yourself. Am I with him? Yeah, but I'm not saying it out loud. She was great. All right. Well, it doesn't matter. I don't want to put... You might be a part of that new generation without labels and stuff, where you're like, you know what? I don't believe in labels. We just are two spirits that found each other.
Yes.
Is that... That's... I'm on the right? Okay, good. All right. That's good. Two spirits that found each other. I found my spirit partner in a strip club. It's a weird thing. It's a weird thing when you find someone you think you're gonna be with for the rest of your life in the place where people say, don't ever meet anyone. Yeah. Like, you're supposed to treat the strip club like it's the porno store where you wear a hat real low and you sit in the back and sip like watery beer and just stare, and then you know, every once in a while give a dollar. No. Not me though. I was fully invested. I was like, you will be my wife. She was spinning on the pole at that time. Just sit there with a dollar, like, this is my first step into happiness. She's cool. She's a regular person, which shocks people, because sometimes people think, like, if you're a stripper, you just think stripper thoughts, whatever those are. Like, every light post, you're like, I wonder, can I make a dollar here at this subway station? It's not real. But she's good peoples. A little bit on the crazy side, but you gotta be. A stripper has the same craziness in her head the way you gotta, like, accept that a professional MMA fighter has it. Like, you know, you gotta be a little crazy to get punched in the face for money. Has anybody ever been in a fist fight before?
Yes.
It is awful. Fist fights are not fun. Like, they're not this thing to, like, love and want to get into. So, like, you have to have a special perspective to be able to go out every night and say, someone's going to kick me in the face, and that's totally okay. I can't be like, whoa, let's call the cops. This dude just hit me in the knee. No. And it's the same thing. This dude is going to wear very thin running shorts. And that's okay. Like, I gotta... this doesn't feel right at all. Just gotta love it. You ever been to a strip club, sir?
Oh, well.
You're acting like the mediator from your divorce is in here. Oh, well. For any prying ears. Huh? And youthful indulgences, right?
Once or twice.
Once or twice. Were they local within South Florida or abroad?
Palm Beach?
Palm Beach is weird. Everything you've ever heard about Florida exists within its strip clubs. There's a guy fighting a gator. Some of the women look like gators. Like, but you can have a good time. You can have a good time. There's weird laws with strip clubs too. Like, a lot of people think all strip clubs are just the nastiest whatever you can desire happens, but strip clubs have these weird laws where it's like, in certain states, if you serve liquor, you cannot have anything on the bottom showing. You can have your breasts out and that's it. Florida doesn't give a fuck because this is Florida. Florida's like, get drunk, touch her cooter. Uncle Remus would want you to do that. The rest of the country has Sam, ours is Uncle Remus. Who's happy the election's over?
Yeah.
Yeah? I hear some unhappy people. This guy, you're just happy? Or are you like on the... Okay. It felt kind of tight, right? Remember like that feeling of walking around and everyone was just... Right around like September, October, when it was getting really serious and you knew who you had to pick between, like the two, three names. Oh, that was some...
I'm happy it's over myself because I can get back to robbing people. It was too tight. It was too much friction going on. Like, people were really adamant about their point of view on whoever. Like, if you was a Hillary supporter, fuck everyone else. And if you were a Trump supporter, it was like, fuck yourself. Like, you didn't give a fuck if you were even happy. Like, you were just like... It's like when... I feel like everyone that kind of went, not everybody, but a lot of people on that side of a lot of issues were just basically like angry drivers. You know, like when you've had enough on the highway, if this guy cuts me off one more time, I'm gonna play that game where I get in front of him and I'm tapping my brakes. And that's what, like, it feels like people just tap their brakes across America, like, fuck you, motherfucker, for tailing me all day. I'm gonna vote for Trump. Like, that was in the rear view. Ugh. I think he's the old white man Obama. Remember, like, how Obama was like hope and change for a lot of young people? I think like Trump was like hope and change for like old people. Like, this guy's gonna take it all the way back. Like, back when I was young. Because that's all it is. We're all looking for the opportunity to be young again. And sometimes we do it with our music, sometimes we do it with our clothes, and sometimes we do it with how we vote. Like, I went to a 50s bar, and this place was really authentic, because they didn't let me in. They were like, we stick close to the authenticity, please go around the back. I was like, this place is good. This place is really good. I'm gonna go outside. So, we're fighting now. We're all fighting. How come they want to get rid of the Indians some more? That's weird. I thought that war was over. I thought they, like, was done. And they still, like, Trump got in and was like, one more time. What's really crazy is people sometimes forget, like, there was a time when he wanted, like, he didn't want Indians to have their casinos in California. And he would take out advertisements and all that stuff talking about not wanting the Indians to have that land because they don't pay taxes. This guy remembers. He was all over television talking about how Native Americans don't pay taxes and this is land that should be owned by people with money that's gonna put it back in the economy. And now, like, it went all the way around and he's like, I'm president. I'm getting my land back. Like, this was a long con just to get to the pipes. That's funny. It is, just the dedication. This dude has, there's one thing we all can agree, this dude is dedicated to anything until he doesn't want to do it no more. That's everything he's ever done. He was like super about doing it, and then one day he said, fuck this, and then walked out. Like his like half-built buildings, he poured a bunch of money and then said, fuck it. Same thing with like paying people in general. He was like, I'm gonna pay you, motherfucker. And then he was like, fuck it. I went to his house once when I was a kid. I was young. It wasn't like a Michael Jackson thing. He gave me a bunch of liquor and pills. I went to his house in Palm Beach, Mar-a-Lago. That place is amazing. There's like gold fixtures and like a gold covered toilet lid. Like, I remember walking around his house. And then, like, that memory came back to me, and I thought to him for a second, like, of course he would think minorities are pieces of shit. Like, you gotta understand, if you have a gold toilet, why would you ever care what anyone has to say about anything? No problem is real. You're like Willy Wonka walking around in your chocolate factory, but the whole world is your chocolate. Nothing is real anymore. I'm gonna get in my long limousine, drive to my house covered in gold, fuck my foreign wife. And then I'm gonna do it again tomorrow. And then someone says, hey, what about poor people? Who? Get out of here. It's not even a joke. I'm tired of being black. That shit is fatiguing. For real. Like, when you're black, you worry about things that you really shouldn't give a fuck about. like your blackness is constantly on your mind. Like I understand, when I was younger, I thought white people would just, like they thought about being white, and then I had white friends and I realized whiteness isn't a thing to you. It's just, you wake up, you go to work, you do whatever, you just do whatever you can do. But like when you're black, you constantly think about it, and it even affects like your behavior. Like you start doing weird things and changing how you act. Like you don't want to eat watermelon out in public. You're like, oh, I don't want people judging me. Which is absurd, because it's not like white people hide cheese whenever a black person is around. Put the brie away, Daquan's coming. Put the brie away. Oh my God, hey man. Just out here having some beef jerky? Is that what you guys eat? Stupid. I'm like a new generation of black myself. I feel it. This is the new one where like I still have the fury and the anger of the 60s, but like I'm stuck in 2017. So like I'm angry like Malcolm, but I'm comfortable like Carlton. Like I want to protest, but then Doctor Strange is coming out the same day. Sorry, man. I'm not black enough to. I just want to watch fucking movies and sit around and do nothing. But that's not a good way to live. I'm already fat. That's like a highway to hell of death. Like, you just gonna be fat and not move around? I gotta lose weight. I saw a picture of myself sitting down in a white t-shirt. I look like melted ice cream. I look soft serve. I was like, are you okay? You've been like doing all these things this whole night, like you're about to turn into a werewolf. Oh, that would be amazing. You having a good time?
What?
You having a good time so far?
Yeah.
All right. I'll believe you. You're here. You should talk to that guy. I don't know what you're going to talk about. Strip clubs. You ever been to a strip club?
In Las Vegas, yeah.
How'd you like it?
I mean, I haven't been since, so.
So I guess that's like telling or something? Like, someone tried to burn me with a cigarette.
One time thing.
All right. Strip club in Las Vegas.
When in Vegas, you're supposed to stay there.
You were supposed to stay there?
No, I got that information.
Okay. Vegas is a weird city in that it's the only place you're excited to leave more than when you was excited to come in. But it's not like a good excited. You know, like when you're coming into Vegas, everyone's like, Vegas, yeah. When they leave, they're like, let's get the fuck out of Vegas. Yeah, we need to get the fuck out of Vegas. I went to Reno once. And I thought I was gonna be close enough to just go to Vegas. It's totally too far. Yeah, that's one of those weird things where I was like in Reno and I was like, all right, let's go to Vegas. And they're like, Vegas is 6 hours away. I was like, let's stay in Reno. They have nothing to do there. It's just a big lake. That's it. I told people I was from Miami and they're like, the big city? Wow. And I was like, the place where somebody ate somebody's face? The place where there's a mosquito giving kids shrunken heads? Like, that's the big city to you? That place is a shithole. Place is awesome. They were voted the worst drivers in Miami. Which, I mean, everyone's on coke, so. You kind of got gray with a curve. I think on stuff like that. You guys are really good coke drivers. This is really good. All right. So I talked about the election. I never really said my thoughts because I don't have any. I did say my thoughts. This should all be happening in my head, by the way. I shouldn't be telling you guys all this right now, like running through my joke list in my head. Like, what else would I tell them? Relationships. Has anybody ever been like, you got with somebody and then it made you realize your ex was crazy? No one's ever been like that? Where you broke up with a person and then you got with a new person, you were like, wait a minute, that person was crazy. Because you start doing things like irrational, you start still doing the irrational behavior you used to have to do, where you like pretend you're at a friend's house and you're like, just tell her we're here together. And then you get a new girlfriend and you're like, I'm just gonna hang out with Tony, like waiting for the fight. She's like, have a good time. You're like, you're not gonna blow up on me? You're cheating on me. I know it. Yeah, I don't trust you, motherfucker. All right, man, you guys have been awesome. Thank y'all very, very much. My name is Hennessy Williams. Please give it up for your host. This is Ed.
Keep it going for Hennessy Williams, everybody. Keep it going for all the comics you guys saw tonight. Keep it going for yourselves because you guys were great. Thank you all so much for coming out. That's the end of our show. Have a good night. Get home safe. We hope to see you again sometime. Good night, everybody.